All right, so we want to welcome you up to Coors Field. Ran into some technical difficulties, but glad to have you here. Currently is the bottom of the first. Grandview is on top 2-1. Colin May is at the plate, so we've gone through a couple of batters here, and glad to have you is kind of where we are. I'm up here. I'm Jake Chau here with Devin Imsirpasic. How are you doing, Devin?
I'm doing good, Jake. You know, we got started a little later, but it's a beautiful day. Love to be at Coors Field. You know, we got a great press box here and a good game so far. A lot of runs so far, a lot of base stealing, you know. It's been an exciting one so far, so I'm excited.
Yeah, definitely. So Colin May is at the plate right now and hitting righty, of course, so. Talked to a couple of the players. They said that they're really excited for this Coors game, just the atmosphere and everything about this game is just immaculate. A lot of the time it's a senior-type game, and there's that one goes in for a strike, so 2-2 count here. Senior-type game, and as a little homage to the seniors, of course, and yeah, absolutely excited to have you. And you know what? The biggest thing that the players said to me is that they're excited for the weather. 73 degrees is what we see up on the scoreboard. Sunny, an absolutely gorgeous day for baseball. Last year, it was low 30s and snowy. So, I mean, what better time to play baseball in weather like this?
Absolutely. I mean, it's perfect. You got a lot of Grandview crowd out. You see some ThunderRidge as well. And like you said, it's exciting for the seniors, you know. You get to play at Coors Field. They're calling it an exhibition game. Won't count for the record, but I bet everyone's excited to be here and ready to have some fun and hopefully play a good game.
Yep, so Colin May walked, which puts runners in the corners. And a big thing that coaches were emphasizing is base stealing. They said that even though they have nearly 30, 40 base steals this far in the season through, 10 games, they don't feel like a good base running team, and they got to do better at that. So runners in the corner are high likelihood, although Colin May is on the base. He's the catcher, so you don't see catchers run a lot. They don't see him bat a ton either, so we could see this be that. This one fouled away.
Yeah, Jax Pfister, the first baseman at bat. You know, he says he wants to play physically better this year. I mean, he's a junior. He's coming in after a lot of seniors from last year's team left for this baseball team. Grandview's been good this season, but they've had to have some guys step up, and Jax has done just that. You know, he has a lot of goals for himself, and he's played pretty good so far this season, and we're excited to see if he can continue that in this game, in this exhibition match, and live up to his goals, he said, as you talked to him yesterday at practice, and he just laid out his goals that he wants everyone
absolutely
to know.
Yeah, an all-state pitcher was first in the Centennial Leaguers, co-pitcher of the year, as this one roped into left field. Jax Pfister getting himself an RBI. Yeah, Jax was telling us how even though he's an all-state pitcher, co-pitcher of the year for the Centennial League, his goal is to be better on the offense, playing first base, so he's going to get in and get more reps. And, you know, he's doing some great stuff already. Roped one into left and gets himself a single. So Ethan Walksman to the plate now. And that'll strike out the side. So Caden Frizzle goes up to the plate and, up on the mound and gets out a three-run inning. The Wolves on top 3-1 after one. Parker Morris on the mound for the Wolves on the defensive side. He's also talking to him. His goal for just not necessarily the game, but also the season as a whole is to limit the walks and limit the runs. Being a senior, he does have some post-high school plans for baseball. He's going to play JUCO in Washington, looking at Clark College. Said that he's really excited about the coach and how old school, and he likes the conditioning. I mean, he comes in at, I believe, 6'4", and absolute lanky, tall, a little bit skinny, he even told us, and his goal is also to bulk up, so absolute threat on the mound if he gets going.
Yeah, Morris, you know, he has that wingspan, and that's really unique in a pitcher, like having being able to get that ball out quick at the mound. And as you said, has JUCO plans as a senior, and he did a great job in that first inning he pitched. You know, he allowed a run, but a lot of Thunderridge, how they got those runs, were stealing bases. They did a great job of stealing bases, so you got to watch out for that from the Grizzlies as they get up to bat once again. But Morris did a good job. He got three outs, all strikeouts, and so he can pick it up there. And as you said, lanky, unique pitching style, but Morris has been pretty good.
Absolutely. So here to start this second inning is going to be Evan Olds. He's in the sixth spot. He'll take the first outside. That one lands in there for strike two. So 1-2 count here. This one fouled away into down the right field line.
And Evan Olds up right now, the junior, 14 at-bats this season, but only one hit. So he's been struggling so far this season, Olds, and especially against Morris now, down 1-2 as for a ball, but a bit of a struggle so far for him. We'll see if he can get it going here.
Yeah, I mean, he does is a little bit more of a pitcher. So, I mean, you don't expect that much out of him, the world, at the batter's box. But actually, on the other side, as this one's hit well into center field. And easily caught there. That's great positioning there from Cam Kennedy to get the put out.
Yeah, ball came straight to him. Easy catch there, Kennedy. Kennedy, I'm pretty sure, had that earlier before he went live. He had a diving catch on one just like that, except he had to move for that one. Got on the ground. So Kennedy's been good in the outfield so far this game.
So up now is Ben Paquette. He has a brother on the team, a freshman, although Ben is a junior. Second year varsity guy, 7 games played, and again, he's been struggling a little bit in the batter's box as this one's fouled back. Only one hit in 12 ABs, so again, this is not a real game that counts. It is a little bit of a scrimmage type, you were saying, an exhibition game, so anything as that one's tipped, and that goes for strike three.
Great pitching so far this inning from Morris. Strikeout there. Got Olds on the last one. Two strikes. And then got him out with the pop fly. But great job so far from Morris in both innings so far.
This one, landing foul. Hudson Fagerholt, the third baseman, up to the plate. Fagerholt, 3 hits and 20 ABs, and now he gets another. Roped it into center over Morris's head, and that'll go for a single.
Number 12, Alex Wells.
Alex Wells, the freshman, up to bat now. His first year being on freshman as a varsity, especially for baseball, really impressive. You see baseball coaches, they like to have that experience on their team. A lot of seniors, they like to start out the freshman early, JV, whatever. But Alex Wells, a freshman on varsity, impressive. And he hasn't been too bad, 2.31 batting average this season, especially for a freshman. Last in the order as well.
That'll land in there for strike one. So 1-1 count, 2 outs. pickoff attempt at first goes back. Looks like Easton Flores is going to hold down the first base. Lands outside, so 2-1. Fastball goes in for strike two. 2-2 count. Outside, go for ball three. So loads up the count, two outs here. Alex Wells. Outside, ball four. The full count walked.
Now,
so that brings us back up to the top of the order. Brock Lansville, the 5'8 pitcher, although he has gotten some significant playing time in the field, playing first base today. 269, and he ropes it into left field. Neither Kennedy or Johnston will get there, and that'll score one. Play at the plate, not in time. Brock Lansville has himself an RBI double.
What a hit from Lansville. Drops it right in between the center fielder and the left fielder. And a great job by the runners as well getting in. RBI double gets ThunderRidge right back in. Tied at 3 apiece.
And he actually swung in the very first pitch of the game. Got the better of Parker Morris.
So yeah, we've seen Lansville have Morris's number early on this far with two at-bats in two innings.
And that'll be strike three.
Yeah, what a pitching sequence there from Morris. Two straight, right down the middle, not getting him swinging on the last one. Caught the batter swinging, caught Buehner swinging. That'll end the inning, but good job by ThunderRidge to get that RBI double, good hit from Lansville. Just either tied.
Yeah, and that's a great way to bounce back after that RBI double. Parker Morris able to keep calm and keep composed as he gets a three-pitch strikeout after that. So. And that's a huge thing that Coach Scott Henry has been saying is that they want to limit big innings. So that's one thing that has killed them all year is that they make one mistake, they make another mistake, and they realize, oh, we're out of it. Coach Scott Henry was saying that 120 pitches on offense, 120 pitches on defense, and he feels like his team is only focused for about 80 on each side. Really staying locked in is his exact words. For all 120 pitches on both sides, again, limiting those big run innings. And that's really been killing them. That's been their Achilles heel in Arizona and even coming back now. So stop the bleeding. Focus mentally is a big part of the message that he's sending to his team.
Justin.
So Brock Johnston to the plate here. This one hit to the second baseman on one hop and easy put out there. 4-3. Put out straight to Ben Paquette.
Now Ben, the second baseman, number 19, Tucker Smock.
So that brings back up Tucker Smock. Top of the order here. He got the bats going early. Like it came up high, it'll be a ball one, so 1-0 count. That one landed outside. Could be a little bit low too. 2-0 count. We also talked a little bit to Tucker. Really said that he's excited for this game and just the atmosphere. Hasn't had a ton of experience on varsity. Has swung a lot last year, but his first reel as in getting a vote of confidence is on the 3-0 pitch goes in and 3-1 count. So he's excited to be here and just get the atmosphere and actually get a real shot to play not only this season but at Coors Field.
Yeah, Smock, one of the bigger players for this Grandview team.
Ground ball to third is in time. Alex Wells, the freshman, came up on it and he gets the put out.
Great throw. He ripped that one right to the first baseman. Barely able to get there before Smock reached first base and a great out. Two at-bats and two outs. Great job in the outfield so far from ThunderRidge and from the pitcher.
Yeah, and that's a great reach there also from the first baseman. Is this one, is it high, shallow right, chasing it down, can't quite bring it in. So it'll be a foul ball. Lansville and Olds were looking at each other just saying, yep, that's my bad.
Yeah, unlucky there, had it right there. Maybe sun got in his eyes, something there. Unfortunate though.
Yeah, we have on-field reporter getting at information. He was saying that how hot it is down there. Yeah, it feels 73, but the sun beating down and continuously with no shade can really get to these athletes, though. So after the foul ball, the 0-1 will come in high. 1-1. The 2-1 roped into right center. Cam Kennedy gets himself a single. Two outs.
Great hit from Kennedy. We were talking earlier. Hasn't gotten that much playing time this year, but so far he's been the main player in here. Got that diving grab in the top of the first. Caught another pop fly in here. Getting on base with a single. Great game so far from Kennedy.
A pickoff attempt. No good. And that's actually a huge part of practice on Tuesday. On Wednesday. On Tuesday, they came off the huge 6-3 win over CT. And then on Wednesday, I practiced. Thursday, they had a game against Arapahoe, which they won, and which is a huge win, too, after a team riding high off a 9-inning walk-off as this one goes foul down left field. And then they had today's game, and then they have a game tomorrow. So a ton of games in this stretch, and so a light practice. They were working on base running, and it had been a bit spotty, but coaches felt like they were a really good team. They just didn't feel like it, that they were meeting that potential. So expect to see a lot of runs, stealing a lot of bags, and being aggressive on the base path. So the 0-1, two outs, swing and a miss, strike two. And Tony Crow really wanted that one. And Tony Crow actually leading this team in batting average. hitting an insane 3-5-3 as this one's fouled back. It's 12 hits and 35 ABs, 9 RBIs, and double, a triple, and a homer. So he can really do it all and play all sorts and all around. This one popped up, shallow infield, and collected easily. And that'll retire the side. So one hit from Cam Kennedy, and that's about it. Keeps it a 3-3 game going into this third inning.
Yeah, ThunderRidge picked it up in that one. You know, we saw the RBI double from Lansville, and they did a great job in the outfield, you know, catching all the pop flies, getting, and we saw Wells from third base have a nice rip pass over to first base to get the batter out. And ThunderRidge just was the better team that inning, and they were able to tie it again 3-3 through two innings. Pretty high scoring for standards, especially in this exhibition game. So
coming up for the Grizzly is Dingus, Fisher, and Frizzle. Patrick Greenemeyer coming in on the mound for the Wolves here. This one fouled right field, goes foul. One gets him swinging. Actually, a quick a sub coming in as that one's fouled away. Alex Aniga. Six ABs, one hit. First year varsity, 8 games played. The 0-2 is high. That one also away, so 2-2 count here, no outs. That one also high, so 2 straight strikes and 3 straight balls. Loads up the count. That one gets away.
Fortunate there, got it to 0-2, and then 4 straight balls for Greenemeyer on his first.
So Will Fisher, the catcher, will come to the plate here. This one, little blooper. Greenemeyer calling for it. He gets it and will fly out to the pitcher. You don't see that one in the box score too often. So Trevor Huettner will come in now. 6'2" senior. And he's typically a pitcher, so likely see him next inning as stole the bag, gets in safely.
We see ThunderRidge, a lot of stolen base attempts, and they've been successful a lot of the time this game. Great job from ThunderRidge, and I bet from ThunderRidge coach calling out those stolen bases. They like to do that. ThunderRidge a little bit lower on the standings than Grandview. Got to find some way to keep up.
This one fouled back into the second row, bounces back to the first. It's unfortunate. Fans do have to return the balls. Would be fun to get a game ball from Coors Field where your kid's playing, but
for sure.
This one roped, shortstop, no good. So that'll score one. Buettner, Trevor Buettner. Roped it into left, and he gets himself an RBI single.
Great job from Buettner. That'll be his second RBI of the season as a pitcher. You know, we've seen a freshman step up. We've seen Buettner, the pitcher, step up at bat. So ThunderRidge playing an all-around good game.
Pickoff attempt, no good. This one low in the dirt, so the 0-0 goes in for ball one. Rita Mayer nearly lost on the putback. There's a swing and a miss, strike one, 1-1 count here. You know, Devin, just take a minute to take it all in, because here we are broadcasting live from Coors Field. It's kind of crazy.
It really is amazing. Being in the press box, we got a really nice setup here. Have a great view of the game, you know. Get to see on the Big Tron. I mean, you really love to see this. I mean, I bet for the players, it's even better for them. So, all around great day for Grandview, ThunderRidge baseball, everyone involved.
Yeah, I couldn't really ask for more. And the Rocky staff have been so helpful and so nice, and even when we're making mistakes or not knowing, it's just they're there to know. As a little check swing will go for strike two. So full count here, one out. Three, two, swung on, hit into right field. Diving for a no good. Ben Crandall couldn't get to it, and that'll be a single that advances the runner to third. That's what you need. Any kind of hits, and you got two back-to-back singles, and already you got runners in the corners.
Yeah, Grizzly's doing a great job of getting those grounders past the infielders and also hitting them not too high, but dropping them in for the outfielders. As you saw right there, Crandall couldn't get to it as first baseman. Steals for second. We see another stolen base there.
Yeah, on the wild pitch. So runners on second and third. Top of the third. A 1-0 count. Green and Mayer. This pitch is swinging a miss, strike two. Go to just a bit outside. This one swung on, shallow left will land, and that'll score two. So a two RBI double, Ben Paquette.
Amazing hit there, getting it right past the infielder and dropping it just so the left fielder had no time to get to it. Scoring two, the second RBI double for two different hitters for the Grizzlies this game. Now, they were down 3-1, and now they scored five unanswered runs, up 6-3.
So Greenemeyer came in for Parker Morris. This pitch low in the dirt. The 1-1 outside, ball two. This one popped back. Nearly came up to us.
Pretty close.
So 2-2 count, one out. Patrick Greenemeyer on the mound. This one hit well left field and tracked down. A pretty easy catch there for Brock Johnston. Didn't really have to do much, just kind of stood there, put his glove up.
Yeah, not as much work required like the last one was for Johnston. Got to that one. Two outs now. We'll see if Grandview can wrap up the inning. Wants to get a third out as Alex Wells, the freshman, steps up to the plate, the shortstop.
So 1-0 goes outside and low for ball two. Swing and a miss, goes for strike one.
High pitch from Greenemeyer. We've seen him a lot of balls throwing it outside, upwards. And then when he does throw down the middle, the Grizzlies taking advantage, getting those hits in. Full count.
Yep, goes in for a strike. So yeah, full count. 3-2, two outs. And a chance to end a little bit of a bigger inning for the Grizzlies. Patrick Greenemeyer struggled this far, pitches in and fouled off.
Yeah, three-run inning for the Grizzlies. You're happy at this point with this, but you got a runner on second. You got Alex Wells, who had already hit this game, had a nice play this game. A freshman who's been pretty good this season. You have him up full count. Opportunity to maybe send that runner at second home. As he gets walked, Wells gets walked.
Yeah, great job working the count, too. Really tiring out Greenemeyer's arms. It takes a lot for a pitcher to stay mentally focused for an entire AB. You want to get those three-pitch strikeouts, those one-pitch groundouts, and it's hard when you throw, you know, we saw at the beginning, two straight strikes and then four straight balls over and over get destroyed in the batter's box. But Greenemeyer, here's a ground ball, sneaks through. And coming around to score, play at the plate is no attempt, back to second. And easily tagged out. So Will Paquette, who came in to pinch it, almost had himself a double. And the run won't count either. So that keeps the score 6-3. As we enter the bottom of the third.
Thank you.
So bottom of the third here coming out of the break. Due for the Wolves, Easton Flores, Patrick Greenemeyer, and Colin May. And correction on the Patrick Greenemeyer call. On the mound, so Nick Martinson will come in. Nick Martinson, another excellent pitcher for the Wolves as they got themselves a nice little rotation going. So that one comes in slow for ball one. That went inside, ball two. Trevor Buettner on the mound now. Bit of an ace for the Grizzlies. As that one goes, three straight balls, but Buettner coming in, only six walks on the season, 11 runs allowed, a 1.75 ERA through eight innings pitched as Flores will be walked on four straight balls.
Flores did a great job of reading all of those. I barely choked up on the bat on any of them except that last one, so. Obviously, Buettner wasn't able to get it in the box, but good job by Flores reading that four straight balls.
And see how he responds, Buettner. Yo-yo inside. This one fouled back. So the 1-1, high and away. This one lifted left center and caught. So a good look there from Nick Martinson, but falls into the glove of the left fielder. Hola. So that brings up Colin May. This one hit well into right center, and that will fall. So Flores looking for three, and May is in for two. Hey, got him. So the relay, Colin May got a bit greedy. And a great relay will be a put out at second base.
Very, very close from our angle behind home plate. I was very close. It looks like the ump saw an out, but I like the decision from May to go too. And now they have a runner on third base with Jack Pfister coming up, their DH.
And Pfister lifted one earlier into a little bit of a fly ball, so. So Flores is on third. This one, ground ball, third baseman, and we'll get there in time. So that'll end the inning. Grandview finds himself in a bit of a hole, 7-3. Going in to the fourth inning.
I mean, you had some good looks from the Wolves there. I mean, Colin May had a great hit right in between the right fielder and the center fielder. Just decided to go two. Ended up not being the right decision, and a great play from third baseman. Once again, the freshman, Alex Wells, able to get it to first base in time, get that third out, eliminate the incoming run from Flores. Just like that, the Grizzlies, after a four-run top of the third, they hold Grandview to no runs in the bottom. So, like you said, Grandview in a bit of a hole now. ThunderRidge coming back up to bat with a big opportunity to even extend their lead.
So top of the fourth here. Due up for the Grizzlies. Ryan McCullough. Alex Saniga. And Will Fisher. On the mound for the Wolves is Brock Johnston. When I went to practice on Wednesday, they were telling us, everybody, how much they loved Brock, how funny he was, and how much of a hard worker he is, and absolute great guy to be around.
Yeah, and we see him play left field. He had some plays early on, up to the mound. Not sure how often he pitches there, but so far two balls. We'll see if he can provide a little spark. They tried Morris. Morris had a decent start, but he did allow a run. Greenemeyer came in, and then the Grizzlies had that really good at top of the third inning. Now onto their third pitcher. We'll see if Brock Johnston brings something different.
Swing and a miss, strike two. Full count here. Ball gets away from May on ball four, so that'll be a walk on the full count. And that brings up Brody Dinges, who comes back in for Alex Saniga. The 0-0 goes for strike one. High and away will be 1-1. Check swing. And got away from the shortstop, Tony Crow. Johnston, a left-handed pitcher. A little bit difficult for a lot of batters and a lot of base runners to read the read the foot angle and the angle of the knee on the pitch to read it. As that one sneaks through Crow. And Dinges will score back at second. May hoses him down. Get it in time. Colin May snipes him from behind the plate.
Great job by May reading that, knowing that the runner going home already made it there, and then seeing that Dinges wanted to go to two, and a great rip over to the second baseman to get it out. But also a great hit from the Grizzlies. Gets another run on the board for them.
So that will be the first out of the inning. The 1-0 low and away. So in comes Landon Zettner. Senior in his first year of varsity, and he's actually batting 500. Only 12 ABs, so 6 hits on 12 ABs. 2-1 count on him now. Low in the dirt, go for ball three. That one lands in there, strike two, full count.
Great job from Johnston, coming back from a bad pitch in the dirt, ripping it, fastball right down the middle. Now brings up a full count, one out.
This one hit foul down left field, will land in the bleachers. And strike three on the full count. Caught looking. And that'll be the second out of this fourth inning.
Johnson starting to pick it up at the mound. Great job coming back from 3-1 count. Two straight strikes following one foul ball. Now with Frizzle up to bat.
Frizzle a righty.
And once again, you see, like you said, Brock Johnson, the left-handed pitcher going up against the right-handed batter. As you said, it's a little difficult for the batters. Maybe that's what Coach Scott Henry was aiming for, left-handed pitcher, trying to get some variety in there, kind of throw off the Grizzlies.
1-1 count. That one low in the dirt. Low and inside will be a 3-1 count. And high and away will be three straight balls and a walk. So Isaiah Williams comes in for Evan Oates. First pitch is fouled away. Hit the top of the zone, so an 0-2 count here, two outs. The 0-2 went outside. So 1-2 count here, two outs. Johnson trying to get out of the fourth inning with only one run allowed and floats it in there. So 2-2 count. Low and away. Frizzle won't go.
Back to a full count. We saw Johnson in the situation earlier. Had that ball four, allowed a walk. See if he can change the script here.
Pickoff attempt, no good. So, yeah, two straight strikes led up with three straight balls. Swing and a miss, strike three. Brock Johnston gets out of the fourth inning. So coming up on the bottom of the fourth, Ben Crandall at the plate. And on the mound for the Grizzlies, Cole Egan. Four innings pitched, a junior's first year varsity. And you don't see this pitching motion that often. This one on the ground to the shortstop, and he can't collect. Crandall gets there safely, so I'm not sure if they're going to call that an E. Yeah, it will be. E6 is the call. As that'll bring up Kyle Cacciavillani. So the 0-0 to Cacciavillani is high. This one high and away also. So 2-0 count here on Cacciavillani. Egan has four walks this year. And a 3-0 is low, or excuse me, a 2-0 is low in the dirt for 3-0. Absolutely beautiful day for baseball here from Coors Field. 20th and Blake. That one outside, going to be another free base for the Wolves.
Now batting center, number 19, Tucker Smock.
So that'll bring up Tucker Smock, top of the order in this fourth inning. And again, in high school, only 7 innings played, so not that much time left. We kind of getting into these later innings here, and anything after the 5th and 4th, you can kind of call it a little bit of a 6th, 7th inning type, so in, as compared to a normal MLB type game. But Wolves find themselves down 5 as that one lands in there for a strike, 1-1.
And they did have a really good first inning hitting, getting the balls through rounders into the outfield while we were still figuring out getting up the live stream, but they had that 3-1 start, but then since then, I think ThunderRidge has just stepped it up in the fielding area.
Smock on the ground to shortstop, and throw is off the base. That loads the bases, no outs, and who else would you have up to the plate than Cam Kennedy?
Center fielder, number 5, Cam Kennedy.
He's had a good game to this. Up to this point, he had a strong first and second inning. You see him get back up to the plate, bottom of the fourth. Bases loaded, prime opportunity. Grandview down 5, if he can get a runner or two in.
The 0-0 goes for ball 1. This one hit high, shallow right field, calling for it, and the sack fly attempt, play up at the plate is not in time. Ben Crandall comes home on the sack fly from Cam Kennedy.
Great speed from Crandall, a taller guy. We have to get there, got there just before the catcher, didn't even have to slide there, got there with ease, and Kennedy, despite a pop fly, able to send it far back into the field, allowing Crandall to get through.
And that'll advance Cacciavillani to third base. It'll be Tucker Smock at first. And that brings up, yeah, Tony Crow, who has been had his bats on fire this year, and that's what he said is the strongest part of his game when we talked to him on Wednesday. And there's a ball hit into right field coming up, and an easy catch. Cacciavillani on the sack fly, the play at the plate is not handled well. And Smock takes the opportunity to steal second. So a couple of sack flies, and what better way to play a little bit of small ball than with some sack flies? So to bring up Justin Dean, actually had a complete game on Tuesday, just 2 days ago, through all seven innings, only five hits allowed in their victory over CT, and players were grateful for him. This one fouled away. Dean in the batter's box, not too hot, 4 Ks, 25 ABs, and batting .250, so not that bad. No walks, though. 6 hit, 3 RBIs, and a double, and a triple. This one low in the dirt, so. Dean, like Pfister, plays some part-time both in the field and as a pitcher, as this one gets around the third baseman. Third base coach waving Smock home, and play will not be in time. An RBI single for Justin Dean.
Here come the Wolves. This is the exact inning they needed. 3 runs already in as they cut the deficit to 2. You see Crow, great at running the bases. Smock, great at running the bases. You saw Catcher Villani get in there. I mean, running the bases, they've done a great job. Thunder is just unable, a little iffy, trying to get the ball at home plate, and Grandview has been able to capitalize on that. Now they're only down by 2. A great 3-run inning so far, 2 outs.
So the 0-0 with 2 outs, high and away. Patrick Greenmayer. Play here. This one inside goes for ball 2. Egan, the 2-0 is fouled first base line into the bleachers. So 2-1 on Greenmayer. He had a fly out to left field in the third inning. The 2-1 launched into center field, and that'll be it. Dingus getting under it and puts the inning away. So a little bit of a big one for the Wolves. 3 runs and this score back to a 2-run lead for the Grizzlies. So coming out of the break here, Easton Flores on the mound for the Wolves. Lucas Schmitten. At the plate for the Grizzlies. High and away. Two oh inside. So three straight balls for Flores. And that'll be four straight, a walk. Lucas Schmitten. The 0-0 high will be ball one. Arbiso at the plate, and that'll be a hit by pitch. So a walk and a hit by pitch for Easton Flores. No outs, runners on first and second. That'll bring up Eli Jackson. 5'10 junior. Two hits and 10 ABs as that one's high and away. Allen lands in there for a strike. So 1-1 count for Flores on Jackson, and Wolves doing their best to hang around, and that's kind of the goal right now. Pitch inside. Coach Henry was talking to us saying that he wants to take this game by game, not take it too seriously. And they've had a couple of straight weekends where they played three games on three consecutive days. This one no different, as the pickoff attempt close, but not in time. Justin Dean on first in place of Easton Flores. Yeah, they've had a couple of three-game weekends. Is this one lifted into right, shallow right, being waved around. Played a third. Couldn't quite gather. Greenemeyer on the putback, and one run scores for the Grizzlies, and on the error. Lead back up to three. And runners on second and third. So Will Paquette. Another freshman on this team. Has one hit and 12 ABs. That one high. But the Wolves have gone 1-2 in three straight weekends. So long games and long weekends that they typically play. And so no worry about fatigue playing this much in such a short span of time. But have gone 1-2 in each weekend. And his goal is really to focus on going just 2-1 even. pitch behind Paquette. As that'll be another walk for Flores. Coach Scott Henry going to come out and talk to him.
Unfortunate last couple of ABs for Flores. A lot of balls, and the one time he gets it down the middle, an RBI single for the Grizzlies.
And so, yeah, Flores will come out. Struggled a bit in that. Imagine they'll put in Justin. Not sure if he's met his recovery time yet. Gonna put in Tony. Tony Crow gonna try out pitching a little bit. Hasn't had much time on the mound, but hey, an exhibition game, isn't it worth trying something?
Exactly. This is going to be their fourth pitcher of the game. I mean, Crow doesn't have any stats, but got to try something if you're Coach Henry now. They have 9 runs through 5 innings, still in the 5th inning. I mean, got to find a way to slow them down. 9 runs through 5 innings, not the greatest showing.
No, definitely not. And that's something that the Wolves have struggled with a little bit this year. High expectations for this team, but the pitching staff hasn't really met up to those expectations like they have been hoping. So they've shown glimpses, is what Coach Henry was talking to us about, but they just need more games together and need more games to really start going. And you could see what happens when they play not even at their top, but just good enough. A seven-inning complete game for Justin Dean earlier this week against CT is exactly what you need, and a lot of it's going to come through the closeness and the connection between all the pitchers in that pitching room. Is a couple of great friends, Nick Martinson and Jax Pfister. They said that they were both each other's best friends, and Justin Dean, a couple of great juniors on that team, and then Patrick Morris, Kyle Cacciavillani can get in there too. Ben Crandall was a little bit of an ace last year, so an excellent pitching room, but really just need more reps and more opportunities.
Perfectly said. It's awesome to have that chemistry, but as you say, if you got to go through 4 pitchers, especially taking one out mid-inning through the struggle, that's where you got to get those reps in. And I mean, this is an exhibition game. This is a perfect time. They're playing against ThunderRidge team who's shown time and time again they can get on the bat, swing it all the way down into the field. But like you said, they just need reps, and you said it perfectly. You can have the chemistry, but got to make sure you get that in. So
someone swung on, fouled back. So 1-1 count, Crow places it in there and swung on. And man, he doesn't have that bad of a fastball. He can get some heat on that.
I mean, if Crow can do it everywhere else on the field, running the bases, hitting, stealing bases, all that, why not try it at the mound?
And Chase Chapman, the junior, going to come in his place at short. And you need a little bit of a cannon from short, not necessarily as much as, say, an outfielder or a third baseman to rope it in there, but I mean, got to have a strong arm from on the other side of second base. How am I going to talk to his pitcher? And, you know, that's a huge connection, too. Have a little bit of a dual threat behind the plate. Colin May and A.J. Maroney both getting some reps as this one lifted into right field. That'll score 1. Off the umpire. And hey, luckily it's an exhibition game.
There's another run in for ThunderRidge. I mean, it's just been great hitting so far. I mean, through and through again, they've shown they have guys, you know, obviously not as high on the ranks before the game coming in as Grandview, but in an exhibition game right now, they've had the upper hand on the Grandview pitchers and the fielders.
Yeah, and all that matters right now is just having fun. Mm-hmm. That's a nice movement there on Crow's pitch.
Especially at Coors Field on a nice day. That's where you want to have fun. I mean, especially if it doesn't count towards the record, like you said.
Yeah, a lot of the time after a couple of losses, it's been about just connecting, and the mood and the mentality has been great. after games and really coming together. And when we were at practice on Wednesday, coming off the CT win, had to feel nice as their strike too. And Tony Crow heating up a little bit. Bit of a quick pitcher. And swing and a miss, strike three. Tony Crow catches a K.
His best at bat for sure right there. Catching the batter swinging multiple times, especially with bases loaded. Clutch one there to get the first out on the board.
So up comes a lefty. Crow's pitching like there's a pitch clock. Got him turned off here, Tony. So 1-1, one out. And that one way inside nearly hit Zettner.
There's that fast pitching coming in. Yep. You see some outside pitches there. Crow.
Never going to forget the time. For those of you who don't know, played a little bit of rec ball. Nothing too crazy as that one hit the far side of the box. That'll be a go-in for strike one. But I tried a little bit of quick pitching like Tony is now, and the umpire came up to me actually and said, slow it down, bro. It's going too fast. So there's some philosophy a little bit behind it as there's a swing and a miss fouled away.
Call him out.
Yeah, strike three.
There's two straight outs, yeah. Two straight at-bats, strikeouts for Tony Crow with no pitching experience this season so far.
And sometimes that's the best because you don't get in your mind. A lot of the time the pitchers will get in their mind, all right, what do I want to throw? If you're just throwing straight fastball, straight heat down the middle, it doesn't really matter. And there's the philosophy coming in hand as the 0-0 comes in for strike one. Low in the dirt for ball one.
And also doing this while the bases are loaded as ThunderRidge has a chance to almost double Grandview 6 runs right now. Crow doing this really impressive.
Swing and a miss, strike two. And the 1-2, low and away will be ball two. I got to try out Crow in some tight situations later this year. If he's pitching this well, like, maybe it's the chorus effect.
Chorus field.
Pitch. Got him looking. Three straight Ks. Tony Crow. Welcome to Coors.
I mean, what a performance there from Crow. Like, three straight after zero outs. Bases loaded. All the pressure. ThunderRidge with a chance to increase their lead. Almost double Grandview. And Crow comes in. Pitches seems like every 10 seconds the fast pitch, and he comes in and he does it with no prior pitching experience on the season. That's probably the highlight of this game, especially for the Wolves.
So on the mound now for the Grizzlies, Caden Davis. This is his first year varsity. Only has one inning pitched, but got destroyed in it. Six runs allowed, putting his ERA at 21. So great for the Grizzlies to get him a little bit of experience in a less stressful environment, a little bit more relaxing. Hey, man, go out there, have some fun. But, hey, maybe the Wolves can take some advantage and get some bragging rights as we get down to the bottom of the fifth. Not that much game time left.
Exactly. The Wolves can take advantage. I mean, obviously, Davis, only one inning pitch, but as you said, it didn't go good. It could have been something wrong there, but as you said, game doesn't count, but the Wolves, they want to get a win, a comeback win, especially leading almost after completely after the first inning, and now down four. They can get some runs in, especially with the good lineup coming up. It's going to be a huge momentum confidence booster, as you said.
Yeah, three straight returning varsity members from last year, Cullen May, Jax Pfister, and Ben Crandall, and that's been huge for this Wolves team. Coach Scott Henry was saying that this team is unlike any other team that he has faced just because of how close everyone is. Ton of returning starters from last year, two of them, coming up, due up in the order right now, Cullen May and Jax Pfister. But it's also been the senior class has been so special in Coach Scott Henry's 9 years at Grandview. No team has been like this one because they've just grown up together. The seniors all playing in the same club teams, all playing on the same teams, and just really bonding through that. I mean, even I on Rec League, I remember playing with JD and Max Hemster. Not sure if he's going to get any playing time, but won the Little League Championship, actually, with those guys. And
look at that.
The experience, and that's how you get close with these guys, and that's really what matters, and uplifting each other and on that mentality side that the Wolves have struggled with so far this year. So at the plate, Cullen May. Inside, not going to take that one. Most coaches would yell at batters for not standing their ground and just taking one to the back of the leg. That one high. So yeah, Davis coming in, getting his first pitches of game time. Only his second inning. This one hit well, right field, going to land for a single for May. And he's going to go for two, and he's in there. Stand-up double, Cullen May.
Great decision from May. He saw it drop. He saw the right fielder kind of slowing up on the ball, realized, I'm going to take this opportunity to go for two. He tried to do that earlier after a run scored, I remember, and it ended up not working. And it looked like he'll be replaced.
Yeah, pinch runner. And not too uncommon, especially for the catchers. Vinny Holberg will be the pinch runner. And hey, we're talking about Max Hemster. He's due up in the batter's circle on deck. Chase Chapman, the junior, will get the AB here. His brother, Reese Chapman, a infamous name a little bit in Grandview baseball history, committed to Tennessee, and he's actually getting reps. He redshirted last year. This one hit well down the left field line, and the power, you can see it in Chase Chapman and the Chapman family. Yeah he was, Reese Chapman, playing in the SEC at Tennessee, committed his sophomore year, so was absolutely ready to play. Actually got, I believe he was passed on in the MLB draft. You can, a lot of the time you'll see teams take a shot as that one dropped.
I think they ran into each other.
Yeah, the first baseman and the second baseman, William Paquette and Schmitten, ran into each other, and that's the second drop foul ball that we've seen from
that same area as well.
Yep, down the first base line. Anyways, as we were saying, a lot of MLB teams will take a shot just at a raw prospect to see if, hey, we have the rights to this guy, but I didn't end up going in the draft 2 years ago. You could have seen him in the, you know, the 20th, 30th round. You see,
yeah.
Guys go a lot of the time, but didn't really matter. I believe Reese was really set on Tennessee. I mean, committed his sophomore year, must have seen something that he liked. As Chapman pops it up again,
another chance,
and capitalized on it this time. So Zettner makes up for the mistake down the first base line and puts Chase Chapman away. So Davis, the 0-0.
Hit by pitch.
That'll be a hit by pitch, yep. So M Street stands in there strong, and runners on first and second with one out.
It's up there, gets hit, gets the first. Not ideal for the body, but ideal for the game, for the team. Not too bad.
So it'll bring up Brock Johnston. He walked and scored a run last inning in the fourth. That one high. And watch out. I mean, unless the Grizzlies turn a double play, which you don't see very often. That's one of those things up there with, like, home runs in high school ball. You don't see that very often in high school ball. But unless they turn the double play, that'll be the top of the order, and Tucker Smock will be back up. Floats in there, ball three. So 3-0 count from Davis.
Chance to load the bases.
Yeah, he had two walks in his only inning. And Johnson, a lefty. We talked about this a little bit earlier, is that how this is important, as this one's ripped down the first base line, going to be an easy put out at first. But advances the runners. Can't complain about that. So top of the order, Tucker Smock at the plate.
He's coming out for Davis.
Yeah, Davis, that'll conclude his night. Get another two-thirds of an inning in.
Yeah, after only one inning pitch prior to this, some good reps. Obviously not the best, some balls. Got some runners on base, but as you said, exhibition game here at Coors Field, sunny day. Got to get the guys in, you know. Good job by ThunderRidge coach. Switching pitchers just as often as Grandview has been so far in this game.
Yeah, and we were talking before the game about if this was just a varsity game, if they coaches were going to play just varsity guys. And because when we were outside, we saw the team and felt like there were 20, 30, 40 guys out there. But and this is exactly why, as you're going to try a lot of things, you know. What other day will you see Tony on the mound?
Exactly.
So.
Coach is experimenting, and that's what you like to see in an exhibition game.
So Alex Wells is on the mound, the freshman. Two innings pitched, so has a little bit of experience. Has one walk, three hits, three runs allowed. Only nine batters faced. Eight games played, only two innings pitched. We were talking about the Wolves potentially capitalizing on a little bit of an inexperienced pitcher who got blown up and is in his time on the mound and have done so far. Haven't scored any runs, no runs to show for it, but again, small ball is kind of the goal. Bats on balls is all that matters. First pitch high and away. Ball one. One-o swung on, popped up, going to come right into the student section. And oh man, lands in row seat A.
Some competition for it.
And a lucky Grandview fan will not be going home with the ball, but his section cheering for him.
I think that was the first one of the game into the Grandview section.
Wild pitch and in nearly standing up, and the Wolves on the board for this inning. Wild pitch sends Cullen May, Vinny Holbrook, home. So the 2-1, two outs here. Smock at the plate. Swung on, and foul ball. He hit it hard and hit it in nearly the most perfect place down the left field corridor.
Yeah, almost had that one really close, but right outside the third baseline. 2-2 now. Strike here would end this inning. One run so far in the bottom of the fifth for the Wolves.
So 3-2, two outs.
Full count with a chance to end the inning. You got Tucker Smock up. We know he has that power.
High and away, we'll go for ball four. Walked him, got away from him. And uh-oh, Smock caught on the base path. Getting out of it, gonna score at home. And the pickle play got him. So Smock got a little bit greedy trying to catch Wells looking, and Wells wouldn't fall for it, but a run does score. So the lead is cut to two. And if you're Coach Scott Henry, you don't hate that necessarily, because that scores a run on the pickle play. Tucker sacrifices himself and keeps the heart of the order, Kennedy, Crow, and Dean, coming up for the Wolves.
That was probably going through Smock's mind as he did that right there, because you don't see that often. And as you saw there, get the inning to score. Make sure you get a nice starting three for the lineup for the next time they're at bat, as you said. So smart play by Smock, although it might not look like it at first. Smart play.
Yeah, and the bats are getting going here. And that's something that Coach Henry was saying, was as the weather gets warmer, the bats do as well. And you can see it there in the fourth and fifth inning is the Wolves start to get going a little bit and cut the lead to two. So Crow will stay on the mound for this sixth inning, and that's something that the Wolves need here.
Now batting number 24, Katie Rath.
So Rath will come up to the plate here. Lefty batter, Crow on the mound. First pitch in for a strike. And Crow had three straight strikeouts. In the fifth inning, and see if he can carry that momentum. This one outside. Swung on, fouled back. Fouled back again. So the 1-2 can be stuck on this count for a while. And Rath is seeing it well, though.
You can tell this is part of Crow's pitching like technique, is that how fast he goes. You see, he wants to get into it right away. And, I mean, it's worked the past inning, this inning as well. And it's unique, but I respect it from Crow, especially as he's not primary pitcher, obviously, first time pitching this season in this game.
When the dirt will fill up the count, 3-2. We were talking in Kansas City when we went last week about, we went to a Royals game. We were talking about the pitch clock and how many injuries there were in the MLBPA.
Big talking point right now, yeah.
As this one, little half swing, floated to third, and Greenemeyer going to get under it. Nearly collided with Chapman, but ends up working out. And Rath had a little bit of a half swing on that, and that's why it didn't go as far as he really anticipated. If he followed through and really put some oomph into it, could have been farther down into shallow left or even the left fielder's ball. But instead, half swings, and coaches don't want you to half everything. Mm-hmm. So Crow, after the fly out, they call it a line out to the third baseman. Going to get a talk to from his catcher, Colin May, 1-1 count. Two, one, ball outside. This one hit well. Chapman jumps and leaps. Chase Chapman comes down with it. Two outs, Chase Chapman.
Play of the night so far for the Wolves in the outfield, jumping up. We saw a lot of those get past them, either grounding or right over, but that one, Chapman said, no, that one will not get past me for the second out. Great play.
Yeah, and great positioning and great vision of the ball. And Chapman really relies a large part of his game on that, not only on the defensive side, but the offensive side. So showcasing it there. Two straight balls, 2-0 count. two outs. Crow. Work inside, ball four. Jackson will come on in.
Be
a quick pinch running situation. Interesting. Gonna bring in Caden Davis, who pitched last inning, and I don't see pitchers run the bases that often, but here he is.
Interesting. We see Davis out there pitching, pinch running.
Not a ton of hitting, but yeah.
Yeah, seen them out there a lot.
That one inside is Crow.
A lot of balls here.
Yep, five straight. Let's see if the magic is wearing off just a tad. This one swung on, hit well down the right field line, but foul. Bro checking the runner. This one. A little bit more of what he wanted, but lands foul down the right field line. Jackson a bit late to it. That's how I know you're hitting it well, is if you're hitting it down that right field line or getting a bit, early to it. So, seeing the ball well. Strike three, got him looking. Tony Crow, magic is still in him.
Another great inning of pitching for Crow. We saw him come in, bases load last inning, bases loaded, zero outs, and his pitching abilities using his fast pitching technique got them to three outs, not letting anyone score. And here, once again, we saw some batters get on base, and then we saw Crow do a great job tuning that fast pitching. Started to get a little ball happy, throwing a lot of balls there, but you can throw it down the middle with that nice fastball.
Absolutely, and four strikeouts in the game. Does he have more than the Fister at this point?
Right. I wonder if this will go in the stats.
Yeah. No, it won't count. It won't affect the averages, but, I mean, absolutely cooking right now, yep. Tony Crow. So pitching now for the Grizzlies, Fagerholt. Gotten a couple of reps, 3.1 innings pitched, not a single run allowed. So a bit of an ace, although limited time, only nine batters faced. So can't say that much about it. So this is the bottom of the sixth. Not too many frames left for the Wolves. They find themselves down two and part of the order up. Kennedy, Crow, and Dean. This one hit well left. Bench is where it was sent. So the 2-1 count. Strike two, hit the outside corner. Kennedy only three hits and 21 ABs. That one's high, so loads up the count. Kennedy, nine strikeouts, two walks. Imagine it'll be a swing here. And nope, high and away, ball four. Excuse me, that's the full count. A couple of confusions on the scoreboard. So now here's the full count after the 2-2 pitch. So 3-2, swung on. Shallow center. Lost it in the sun and bobbled out of his glove. Play at second. Not in time. Kennedy gets there, uses his speed.
Great play from Kennedy. You saw him hesitate, but the center fielder and the shortstop combining didn't seem to pick it up right away after the drop. And so that allowed Kennedy to go to great slide. Great job getting there right in time.
And this is what he was saying when he talked to us on Wednesday, is that his strongest part of his game is how much he hustles. Gives 110% every single play, whether it's a ground ball, a pop-up, even if it looks like it's going to be caught and bounces out, that's what it is. That's his speed, hustling, and running is everything that his game is built on.
You see that from Kennedy all around, his hustle when he's out in center field, when he's here running the bases. You see it all around. And he's shown it in this game as well. And as you said, he talked to you about that. He knows it as well.
Yeah, he said that his goal was to make the playoffs, and there's a hit by pitch. Or no, it'll be a wild pitch. Didn't hit Crow. Right. Sounded like it from up here.
Crow ducked right underneath that one. That one might have been for his head.
Yeah, he said that Crow's goals was going above 400 on the year, and he's just under it after a couple of, I wouldn't say bad, but subpar compared to his standards and up to his standards himself, that he has for himself. Showings against CT and Arapaho is below 400 as he gets a walk there. So that'll be bring up Easton Flores, so JD will come out. And here's an excellent opportunity to capitalize. Runners in the corners. Flores, ball in the dirt, gets away from the catcher. Play at home, not in time. Cam Kennedy using his speed again. Brings the Wolves within one.
Absolutely amazing recognition from Kennedy. That one, a lot of people, you won't see them have the guts to go home right there, but Kennedy, knowing he has that speed, that hustle, he went for it. Pitcher couldn't get there in time off the wild pitch, just like that. Grandview only down by one run.
Yeah, the best base runners are observant base runners, and great read there from Kennedy.
Yep.
Pitch low in the dirt will be ball two. I remember one of the best moments in my short baseball career was stealing home as the pitcher had the ball. It's observing what's happening as this one's hit well. An excellent hit from Flores. That's going to get to the warning track. Gets around the left fielder. And Flores has himself an RBI double. Wolves tie it up. Here come the Wolves. Easton Flores.
What a bottom of the sixth inning so far. Back-to-back at-bats. You saw Kennedy run around the bases after his at-bat a while ago. And now Flores, one of the best hits of the day. Gets it all the way back to the wall almost. High game now.
Yeah, that's hard to do in a spot like this. A lot of MLB players will say, oh, the COORS effect, oh, the COORS effect. Easy to hit the wall, easy to hit home runs. But, I mean, that's a huge argument. And just off the top of my head, the Todd Helton Hall of Fame argument. But he had more home runs at a better average on the road than he did at COORS. So it's hard to hit in COORS is the bottom line, no matter what anybody says. This one fouled off down the left field line. Rena Mayer. So Fager-Holt came into this game with no runs allowed, 3.1 innings pitched, had 8 Ks, only 4 walks. Already has a couple of walks, a couple of runs, and a couple of hits.
Yeah.
Pitch high and inside. This one hit back to the pitcher, and uh-oh, play back a second. In time, that's going to be an out. Tough read there from Flores.
Yeah, you don't, don't see that hit that too often, right back to the pitcher. And the pitcher made a great play of going back to second, but Flores a little caught off guard. First out, though, still. Some other opportunities to take the lead here with the runner on first. Colin May up to bat.
Yeah, May in his last at-bat got a double using the speed. Fouled off. And again, you were saying a high-scoring affair. 10 runs for both teams. You don't see that very often.
Very good game.
This one roped down the left field line. It'll be an easy put out at second. Double play ball. Not in time. Gets away. And that could have been in time, actually, but
almost.
First baseman couldn't quite come up with it. William Paquette.
Now, shortstop, number two, Chase Chapman.
So to bring up Chase Chapman, who has a bat himself, popped it up to the catcher in his last AB.
He swings with a lot of power at his at-bats.
And hit that pitch, yep. Yeah. Won't get to showcase it as he'll take his base.
First pitch.
And I wonder if umpire came out, I wonder if he gave Fager Holt a little bit of a warning. But that'll bring up Ben Crandall. He's also playing a little bit out of his position. Pitched a lot last year. Didn't get a ton of field time, but starting right fielder, and he's played all game. Runners on first and second. It'll be Crandall at the plate, and then Brock Johnston on deck and in the hole, top of the order with Tucker Smock. First pitch goes high. This team took a trip down to Arizona over spring break, but not for fun, for business. Baseball in Arizona, they beat Kirkland Central by a handedly 15-1. And we're in it a little bit against Hamilton as ground ball to the shortstop will be the end of the sixth inning. So a tie game here. 10-10 as we enter the top of the seventh. Oh, that'll be it.
It's going to be exciting. Oh, that'll be a brand new ball game with one inning left. 10-10, one inning left for them to play.
Oh, that'll be it.
That'll be it.
That will be it. So due to the exhibition game, don't need a winner. So
I see.
And it's only six innings. So that'll do it, actually. A little bit of shock for both of us,
yeah.
But hey, a little bit of comeback for the Wolves.
They came back. They tied it up. That was a win for them. They were down 10-6.
And come back to tie it 10-10. What an experience this has been.
What an experience.
Live from 20th and Blake. Coors Field game and an excellent, little bit of a weird one. 20 runs scored total. Tony Crow
great
on the
game.
Mound.
Really great game.
We had a ton of fun. We're going to thank you so much for tuning in to GVTV. I've been Jake Chau.
I'm Devin Imsirpasic.
And for our entire production crew, we want to thank the Rockies organization and their staff members for their cooperation with us and our dream come true. We want to thank you so much for tuning in. Your final score, Grandview Wolves 10, Thunder Ridge Grizzlies 10. We will see you next time.
Thank you.